Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Robert Vaughn with the Virginia Foundation for the Humanities. I'm delighted to welcome you to the first in what we propose to be a monthly series at noon on the second Tuesday of each month going forward. Our focus will be on the role of the humanities in American public life. And through the humanities and drawing on the resources of the humanities, we intend to help each other understand the past and especially its influence on the present, to address contemporary issues, sometimes controversial, and seek resolution, and to shape a promising future based on the common good. I'm very, very pleased to welcome William Freehling here today, Bill Freehling, who is a senior fellow at the Virginia Foundation for the Humanities. Bill has taught at Johns Hopkins, Michigan, and the University of Kentucky, where he retired as the Singletary Professor Emeritus of History. He has published a number of books, one of which won the Bancroft Prize in American History. His magisterial two volumes on the, and I've forgotten the title, on the coming of the Civil War, The Road to Disunion is the title. And he is currently working on a book on Lincoln and has recently edited the papers, some 3,200 pages in manuscript, to a 180-page volume on the secession convention in Virginia. So we're pleased to welcome him here today. The question he will attempt to answer that he proposes to us is, did slavery cause the Civil War? So, Bill.
I always enjoy applause beforehand, but I enjoy applause afterwards even more. So remember that when I get done. One advantage of being as old as I am is you get to witness a lot of birthdays. And as some other people in here who are as old as I am know, then you can compare various birthdays and they become even more meaningful. So I'm old enough to have experienced two anniversaries of the coming of the Civil War. First of all, there was the 100th anniversary when I was a young graduate student, and now there's the 150th anniversary. And it's great fun to compare them. When I was celebrating the 100th birthday of the coming of the Civil War, I was a graduate student at Berkeley. My professor was Kenneth Stamp. I'd recently been working with Arthur Schlesinger Jr. And they were in the forefront of demolishing what was the conventional wisdom about the coming of the Civil War after 100 years. And that conventional wisdom was that slavery did not cause the Civil War, that in fact nothing caused the Civil War. Instead, a blundering generation of statesmen turned nothing into a war, and this was a most unnecessary war fought by most inadequate statesmen. My professors, because professors have such a great influence on people, myself, we declared war on that notion. And we were determined to prove that it wasn't just blundering statesmen that caused the war, but that slavery was a real cause of the war. I wrote my first book in that vein. I was one of the foot soldiers, not one of the generals, but one of the foot soldiers in that campaign to prove that slavery was the cause of the Civil War. And I think you can say that we triumphed. And on this 150th anniversary of the start of the Civil War, it is a conventional wisdom in the academic world, though not quite yet in the popular world, that slavery caused the Civil War. And for me, it's a basic proof of the proposition that be careful what you wish for. Because the notion that only slavery caused the Civil War, and all you have to say about the coming of the Civil War is that slavery caused it, has become a difficult proposition to accept. Now, I still accept, I'm still proud of the early work I did in this movement. I still think that slavery is the most important cause of the Civil War. I still think that there are too many people, particularly outside the academic world, who don't realize it. And if you want proof of that, we have our governor, who got himself in quite a lot of trouble just a few weeks ago by saying that slavery had nothing to do with the cause of the Civil War, which used to be the official position, even in the academic world. The position that makes no sense. If you look at any aspect of the coming of the Civil War, slavery is crucial. It is unthinkable, at least to me, that you could have had a Civil War without slavery, without the contest between the North and the South. You look at any contest leading to the Civil War, and slavery is foremost in the conversation. I defy anybody to read the addresses and letters of people in the secession conventions in the Lower South and to conclude anything else but that the protection of slavery from Lincoln's supposed menace was the key reason for the first wave of secession. So when I say that we've gone too far with this, I am not saying that it's wrong to call slavery the cause of the Civil War. It is the most important thing you can say about the subject. It explains more than anything else you can say in five words. But unless you're careful with the proposition, it throws you off. And you end up not understanding an awful lot by constantly saying that slavery is the cause of the Civil War, and that's all there is to it. For one thing, the proposition that slavery caused the Civil War has led to an oversimplification, which is not necessarily part of the concept. And the oversimplification is, because slavery is the cause of the Civil War, it must be that the North fought to abolish slavery and the South fought to protect slavery. That the most important thing going on in Northern life when Lincoln was elected was a statement that slavery must be abolished and that Lincoln must abolish it. And the most important thing going on in Southern life after Lincoln was elected was that Southerners decided that Lincoln was a menace to slavery and therefore they seceded. Now, you don't have to oversimplify it like that. You don't have to say that slavery was to the North something that had to be abolished, and slavery to the South was something that had to be preserved by secession. But it's a natural oversimplification. It occurs in most high schools and in most conversations, and it is a very dangerous misconception of what really happened. First of all, it's a dangerous misconception in the North, because most Northerners were not abolitionists. Most Northerners disliked abolitionism. Most Northerners disliked blacks. Most Northerners thought that abolitionists went too far. And most Northerners liked not Lincoln, the person who talked about slavery being wrong, which he surely did, but the Lincoln who adopted the middle of the road on slavery. And the middle of the road on slavery, Lincoln's middle of the road, was that you should stop slavery from expanding, but you should not try to abolish slavery in the South. Slavery is wrong, says Lincoln, and therefore we must not allow it to expand, but we have no constitutional power to abolish it in the South. It's a wonderful middle-of-the-road position, and you all know how politicians flourish in the middle of the in the middle of the road. Let me give you the most spectacular example of Lincoln being in the middle of the road. In the Congress, right before Lincoln was inaugurated, a 13th Amendment to the Constitution is passed. The 13th Amendment to the Constitution in 1865, as you all know, abolished slavery. The 13th Amendment, as proposed and passed in Congress, right before Lincoln was inaugurated, says that Congress shall never abolish slavery, and the amendment is declared unamendable. An unamendable amendment that Congress shall never abolish slavery. And in his inaugural address, Lincoln endorses that proposition. and says that he is delighted that this will forever settle the question of the federal government interfering with slavery. This is Abraham Lincoln. This is the man who is supposedly elected to abolish slavery, but it's typical Lincoln. It's typical of the middle-of-the-road position he's taken. I have to stop for a second to tell you that one of the things that I'm most excited about in my own studies of Lincoln is I'm convinced that Lincoln not only endorsed this amendment after it was passed, but that he originated the amendment, and he was the first to propose it. I'm going to cause quite a stir when I announce that in my book on Lincoln, but it is an example to me of the resistance to anti-slavery in the North, and you have to understand that. What Lincoln is trying to do, he says over again, is to conserve the Republic from the slave power, from the people who are trying to too aggressively protect slavery. He makes the point in the 2 years before he's elected president, not that he wants to stop slavery. He does not argue that he wants slavery to stop from expanding because then it will be abolished. Never says that. He says, on the contrary, he wants slavery to stop from expanding so it doesn't expand over the North. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to contain this poison in the South, a poison that he fears will infect the North. And that is typical of Lincoln's kind of rhetoric. And his point is that there is what he calls a slave power loose in the nation. And that slave power is trying to conserve slavery, and in the process of doing that is destroying the rights of white men, is in fact enslaving white people by insisting that the Congress of the United States must protect slavery. And what Lincoln, the way Lincoln twists the thing is not that he wants to abolish slavery for black people, although he says in the best of all possible worlds nobody would be enslaved, but that he wants to contain northern whites from being enslaved by the slave power. Now, you'll quickly notice that this is an aspect of a slavery issue. It is such a virulent concept in American life that slavery is something bad, and slavery is to be avoided, and slavery is only for blacks, it gives real power to somebody who says that whites are in danger of being enslaved. I see Henry out here, and Henry knows that this goes way back to the American Revolution, when the American colonists were saying that England is trying to enslave them with their various edicts. Slavery is a bad thing in a republic, and that excites people to imagine that it can spread, and it can even spread to white people. So, of course, slavery is a cause of the Civil War, but only in this more complicated and subtle sense, that it is not just the slavery for black people that's at stake, but the consequences for white people. And if you look at the South, you quickly see that it is not true that most Southerners are in favor of secession after Lincoln is elected. On the contrary, most Southerners are trying to stop secession, and thus it becomes a really fun process for somebody like me to try to figure out how you could ever have secession when the majority of Southerners didn't want it. And it goes back to lots of things, and one of them is that a minority that really knows what it wants can always get its way, not always, but often get its way, fighting a majority that isn't sure what it wants. Most Southerners weren't sure what they wanted after Lincoln was elected. The secessionists are very sure what they wanted, and by a series of really shrewd manipulations, they do succeed in getting a minority of the Southerners out of the Union, which by a long process that I don't have time for here, ends up starting the Civil War. And when the Civil War starts, a lot of the Southerners, including most of the Virginians, who had opposed secession, say that now we must secede, and the reason we must secede is that Lincoln, the tyrant, is marching his armies down to the South and is going to enslave us. is going to enslave white people, and we've got to liberate ourselves from the tyrant, liberate ourselves from Lincoln. So is this another example of slavery causing the Civil War? Well, yes. That whole concept in the South that Lincoln will be an enslaver comes from the depth and power of the image of slavery in a republic. But it's not that they thought Lincoln was going to free blacks. It's that they thought Lincoln's armies were going to enslave Virginia by invading our homes, etc. So my point here is that if you look at these issues in a more subtle way than just saying the North is trying to abolish slavery and the South secedes to save slavery, you got to come at it in a more complicated way. But even if you come at it in a more complicated way, you realize that though slavery is the main cause of the Civil War, everywhere you look, it is not enough anywhere you look. That other things have to come into the picture. And the reason other things have to come into the picture is it's a very close contest throughout the coming of the Civil War. It is not a landslide. It is not, for example, like my friends who study World War II see Pearl Harbor. Pearl Harbor happens, and then there's a landslide of opinion for a Second World War. There's no question that there's going to be a Second World War. There is no such landslide in the coming of the Civil War. On the contrary, you have very close contests. Lincoln, for example, was elected president in 1860 in one of the closest elections in American history. If you look at how few votes had to change in the North to throw the election into the House of Representatives, where Southerners had much more power than they had in the popular referendum. As I've said, the secession elections are very close in the South, especially in Georgia and Louisiana. Every step along the way, things are very close. With the Supreme Court that issues the Dred Scott decision, I'm going to be talking about that more in a second, is split evenly between those who want to issue such a decision and those who don't. The votes on admitting Kansas to the Union are extremely close. You always have a very thin margin of opinion. And when you have a very thin margin of opinion, other things start to matter to finish up the process of something passing. And it's in that sense that other things have to be considered when you worry about the coming of the Civil War. Such things, for example, as wise statesmen and blundering statesmen. Let me turn to wise statesmen first. It's not as if there are no heroes in this story. One of the great mistakes that I think was made at the 100th anniversary was we talked only about blundering statesmen. Well, but there were wise statesmen too. My own favorite statesman, my hero of the whole story, as will not surprise my fellow historians here, is John Quincy Adams, who was surely the greatest ex-president who ever was important in American history. Most of you know Andrew Jackson demolished John Quincy Adams. He tiptoed out of the White House in a fury. And usually when that happens, people write their memoirs and vent their spleen the rest of their lives. John Quincy Adams had a better idea. He ran for Congress and sat in the House of Representatives. And he was in the perfect position to turn the so-called gag rule controversy into a very, very important event. The gag rule controversy happens like this. The abolitionists in the 1830s petitioned Congress to abolish slavery in Washington, D.C. The South wants those petitions tabled. They don't want the thing. They don't want the subject discussed. They want the subject gagged, and the gag rules were passed, stopping the discussion of these petitions from interfering with Congress. And John Quincy Adams saw his opening here and saw what you could do with this situation. And what he did was he got up and said, I am not in favor of these petitions. I'm not in favor of abolishing black slavery. I don't know how I feel about that. But I'll tell you what I hate. I hate this gag rule because it gags white people. It stops white people from petitioning Congress. And what we must do is to abolish not slavery, but the gag rule. What we must do is liberate not blacks, but whites from the tyrannical Southerners who want to repress American democracy by stopping free speech. It was a brilliant maneuver. And for 10 years, Adams was like this, tormenting the Southerners and more and more driving this contest forward. Without somebody like John Quincy Adams, without a hero like that and a man with prestige like that and a brilliant politician like that, I can imagine that the gag rule controversy would not have been as explosive as it became. So we talked about the good statesmen. Now I want to talk about the bad statesmen. Because blunders do matter, just as great statescraft matters. And to me, the greatest blunder, and I'm not pulling any surprises here by those of you who know the subject, the great blunderer is James Buchanan, who was president right before Lincoln from 1856 to 1860, a fine old statesman from Pennsylvania who became president in another very, very narrow election and was scared to death that his presidency would destroy the Union. And he was particularly scared of the issue of slavery in the territories, which had become the big issue. The big issue was not whether slavery should exist in the South, but whether slavery should be allowed to expand into new territories. And that issue had caused a tremendous furor over Kansas territory right before Buchanan was made president. And Buchanan was afraid it would destroy his administration too. And he had good reason to fear the power of this issue. So he decided that the best way to avoid a controversy in Congress, the best way to avoid him having to take a position was, as you can imagine, let the Supreme Court decide. If the Supreme Court, in its august majesty, decides the issue of slavery, then Congress doesn't have to worry about it. And the president doesn't have to worry about it. And the nation need not be split up over it. And a civil war need not occur. And James Buchanan's administration may flourish. There is a case before the Supreme Court called the Dred Scott decision, in which one thing the court can do is to declare that Congress can never abolish slavery in the territories because slavery is property and that Congress will be interfering with property rights. Now, the court doesn't have to do this. What the court can do instead is to throw the case out of court on all kinds of minor technicalities. And the court is evenly split between those who want to take on this big issue and say that Congress can never abolish slavery, and those who say, no, we don't need that kind of trouble in the Supreme Court. Let's decide this on narrow technicalities. Let's duck the issue. And the court is evenly split about this, and I cannot say what would have happened in that courtroom, in those closed chambers, if James Buchanan hadn't intervened. But James Buchanan does intervene. He writes his friends on the court, and he says, please decide this issue once and for all. This is when he is president-elect, about to assume the presidency. He knows that if they decide to settle the issue once and for all, they will decide the Southern way. He doesn't care. He just wants the thing decided, so he doesn't have to decide it. So Congress doesn't have to decide it. So he thinks the nation will not be split up over the controversy. I know of no other time in American history when this happened, when either a president or a president-elect secretly intervened in court deliberations to try to urge the Supreme Court to make a decision one way or another. It is an astonishing violation of the principle of checks and balances and separation of powers. And Gordon may know somebody, but I know of no other case where a president tried to intervene secretly like this while the court was trying to decide. To make a long story short, and it took several weeks for the court to decide, even with Buchanan there, the court finally decides to make the big decision to go along with Buchanan and to decide that Congress shall never abolish slavery in the territories, which, as you can predict, did not settle the issue once and for all, but infuriated the North and caused a far worse Civil War controversy than ever before. Now, how can you tell the story of the coming of the Civil War by just talking about slavery, 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 and not talking about what James Buchanan did here? Any more than how can you tell the story of the gag rule without talking about what John Quincy Adams did? People make an enormous difference, and when people make a difference like this, it counts. Still another thing that I think you have to consider if you want to understand the coming of the Civil War is accidents and coincidences. I'm convinced that accidents play a part in my life and in your life. One thing I've often done in college classrooms is to go around the room and say, did an accident ever make, did a coincidence ever make a difference in your life? And invariably, people say, of course. I met a certain person at a certain point. I got sick at a certain point. I had an incredible experience at a certain point. You bet coincidences have made a difference in my life. Well, so too, I think coincidences make a difference in a human life on the large political stage. And it's another example of why historians have to be, yes, humanists. They have to be aware that human life is not just impersonal, grinding down by vast forces over which nobody has control, but it is also sometimes determined by crazy things that happen. Now, let me give you an example of, I think, the craziest thing that happens. John Brown decides that he's going to invade Harper's Ferry. He is a, for those of you who haven't read about this nut, is a Connecticut zealot who believes that slavery should be abolished, and what a real zealot ought to do is to go down south, what a real Yankee zealot ought to do is to go down south and inspire the slaves to start an insurrection. So John Brown decides to raid the Harper's Ferry arsenal and to distribute guns to blacks with the hope that they will rise in revolution. It is a wild idea. It is one that has very little chance of success. Of all the various things the abolitionists do, this is... And some of the things they do are very, very sensible, including petitioning Congress to abolish slavery. This is the wildest. And it's not destined to be very successful. So, John Brown invades Harper's Ferry, West Virginia, that beautiful place that we all visit now, and captures captures the guns and invites the slaves to come wield them. And of course, they don't come since they have they have more common sense than John Brown has. The question is, what's going to happen to this raid? What is happening so far is the Northerners who know about it, and very few of them know anything about it, think that some nut must have been loose who's trying some crazy thing in the South. So John Brown holds himself up in the Harper's Ferry arsenal and awaits what is very likely to be his execution, and very likely to be his executioner is Robert E. Lee, who leads a group of U.S. Marines down to capture John Brown. This is the first time Robert E. Lee becomes important in national history. So Lee's men break into the firehouse where Brown is now holed up. Several of Brown's children are killed, and a man named Israel Putnam comes at John Brown with a huge sword. And he stabs John Brown in the stomach, except he misses. He hits him in the belt buckle. And John Brown lives. And because of that belt buckle, which is not usually considered a great epic cause of the Civil War, because of that belt buckle, John Brown lives. And because he lives, he gets to address his judges. And in that address, which is one of the great speeches in American history, John Brown is essentially addressing Northerners. And he says, "I have done what I've done because I wish to intervene on the side of the poor slave. If I'd intervene on the side of the rich, nobody would have objected. But here I've intervened on the side of the poor, and you object to what I've done. You must not object. I have done a merciful and humane act." And that address is spread around the North, and more people are excited by what John Brown has done. And I submit that if he had not lived to give that speech, his impact on American history would not have been nearly as great. Now, this is what I mean when I say that other things have to be twisted into the story before slavery causes the Civil War. It isn't predetermined that someone like John Brown is going to appear. It isn't predetermined that someone like John Brown is going to get to speak to his judges. That happens as a result of the crazy coincidences that humanists are aware are always part of human life. I could, if I had time, give you all kinds of other examples of accidents which carry the story further. And unless you have this knowledge of the various incidents that happen, unless you have a knowledge that people have made a difference, whether they make great mistakes or whether they do great acts of heroism, and whether you interweave in your story that accidents and coincidences help along the tale, then and only then can you understand how what are very, very close decisions ultimately are swayed in favor of the coming of the Civil War. Does this mean that we must dismiss slavery as the cause of the Civil War? Heavens not. But we need to understand that other things play a part in all this and come into the story. And we need to understand that there is a great complexity involved. So the question is, I think the question at the end of every lecture is, the question at the end of every book is, the question that scholars very seldom face is, so what? What do we care about all this? Why do we need to listen to this for the last 25 minutes? What do we need to know about all these subtle things that go into the help slavery caused the Civil War? When you start out with a sound bite that slavery caused the Civil War, the lecturer says that sound bite is right as far as it goes. Why care about all this other stuff? I think you have to care about this whole story for several reasons. First of all, you have to understand, if you're going to understand American history, how racist this culture is. How this culture is not capable of just deciding that slavery is wrong and therefore abolishing slavery. It takes all kinds of twists and turns for people and for Lincoln to get around to replacing that first 13th Amendment with the second 13th Amendment. And that happens because America is not a colorblind society. It was not then, it is not now, and the more you understand how difficult it was to get this nation to fight a civil war involving slavery, the more you have a deeper sense of the racism that is at the heart of our culture. And secondly, I think it's terribly important to realize that this is a human story and that there are many human stories in history. And if you're going to understand history, you've got to understand what individuals do and the coincidences that affect human life. We are not social scientists, us human beings. We do bizarre things. We do weird things. We have weird things happen to us. And those weird things play into our life, play into the life of our culture, and play into the ultimate outcome of American history. And it's a very important, I think, to understand that this is not just a matter of the inevitability of something happening. The way Pearl Harbor makes Second World American involvement in Second World War inevitable without saying anything else. And finally, there is that question of sound bites. Okay, slavery is the cause of the Civil War. Now, that's a great sound bite, but it's a great sound bite that obscures all kinds of other more fascinating things. And I think that love of sound bites, that love of simplicities, that failure to look at all the complexities of life is the greatest disease of our current understanding of American life. Sound bites take you so far, but sound bites obscure so many things. And the more we understand that life is not sound bites and that understanding is not sound bites, the more we're prepared to face the dilemmas of our own time. So I think we must all go beyond the notion that slavery caused the Civil War, even though that is more true than not. Thank you, everybody. I was telling you, you did applaud after I was done.
Thank you, Bill, for all of that, and especially at the moment for the complexity argument at the end. We do tend to oversimplify almost everything these days, it seems. Bill's willing to take some questions and to listen to some comments, some corrections, whatever you would like to say at this point. We do need for you to have the microphone, which is why I have it and why we had to interrupt there momentarily, because this is being recorded for broadcast. Bill was this morning, today, on Fresh Air, but now he is advancing his career by being on public access in Charlottesville in the future. And all of these programs and the reason why they're being held here is so that they can be recorded and can be broadcast. I'm surprised to learn over the last year or so just how many people do listen to the public access channel. It has a large and growing audience, and we're pleased to be a part of it. So Ann is going to carry the microphone around, or I will, and we will take questions. I hope you have comments for us, and I hope you will join the large television audience to watch this and see how it goes in the future. Well, here, let me hand it to you, and we can work from there.
Thank you very much. I really appreciated your talk. I was hesitant to come with the title, you know. But the question is now, you said we are a racist culture. Even yet, we have to struggle through that, I think. Could you talk a little bit more about that, or do you want to leave it at that?
Well, there are many people here that are much more able to talk to that than I am. I can't call myself a magnificently informed student of American racism in 2010. There's those who think I died in 1865, but we'll leave that aside. But it does seem to me that there are all kinds of racial tensions left in American culture, that there's all kinds of racial conflicts, racial disturbances. There's all kinds of ways in which the black underclass is more exploited than the white lower class is. I could be wrong about that, but it seems to me that we have not gotten over our prejudice, many people's prejudice against blacks, and I want to see us get over it. And I think one way we can get over it is by understanding how disastrous racism was in our past and how much it helped cause the Civil War. How would you answer that question? How would you answer your own question?
Myself. Well, really, I'm trying to figure out you people. I say that somewhat sincerely. I was 37 years in Eastern Africa, living with the people in Tanzania and Kenya, and traveling other parts of Africa, you know, as a missionary. And I've been back, what, 10 years now, and I'm still puzzled by how can we hang on to these things? I mean, it's just kind of incomprehensible to me. So I'm really trying to, I'm not doing any more ministry because I'm afraid I would alienate people more than help them because I haven't been experiencing this culture enough yet.
And my answer is that because it's so deeply rooted in 200 years of our history. And what would your answer be? It's a good question. Thank you.
You gave us the fascinating comments about John Brown's raid and the impact on the Northerners and his speech and all of that and the way it stirred concern and interest in his cause. Could you take the other side and help us to understand the importance of that raid for Southerners? Would you consider that raid tremendously important and leading to secession, moderately important, or overblown in terms of the emphasis?
That's an excellent question, Robert, and thanks by the way, for coming today. I think what is most important about the Southern reaction is the Southern reaction to the Northern reaction. If John Brown had just been killed instead of being hit in the belt buckle, and the Northerners had just paid no attention to this crazy incident, I don't think the Southerners would have gotten very excited about it. But it's what the Northerners do. It's the Northerners' worship of John Brown, you know, John Brown's body and all that stuff that produces Southern rage at the North. And it's in that way that I think it's important. I do not think that the Southerners are scared to death of slave insurrections. I do not think that they expect that Lincoln will inaugurate slave insurrections. There has been, on the contrary, the most fascinating change in what Southerners are afraid of over the antebellum period from their blacks. In 1832, after Nat Turner strikes, the Virginia legislature, as you all know, actually debated abolishing slavery because slavery was so dangerous. One slave insurrectionist could cause a whole state to get on its knees for 2 weeks and consider abolishing slavery. But it never happens again. And instead, the black resistance takes a much more intelligent form, in my judgment, a much more productive form of running away. Blacks running away from white masters instead of trying to murder them. And that is a very effective form of resistance because it inspires the fugitive slave law and inspires northern blacks getting to the north and being chased down. And it's that fugitive slave controversy that sort of replaces the old insurrection thing. What John Brown is trying to do is he's trying to get back to the fear of insurrections. I don't think he succeeds in that, but I do think he succeeds in uncovering all kinds of northern attitudes that these slaveholders just aren't nice people. They're just not pleasant people. I can't emphasize that enough. Northerners don't like Southerners. They don't like slavery. It's that they don't want to take the risk of abolishing it that makes Lincoln take a middle-of-the-road position. What a great question you've asked. Thank you.
Bill, you just touched on a point that I was thinking of when you said that Northerners don't like slaveholders, because one of the things that has always struck me in what little I've read about the Civil War compared to you is the ferocity of the fighting, which suggests that there was a pre-existing antipathy between the North and the South. I mean, the avidity with which they chop each other up. And I remember reading letters where some Southern ladies of very high station were delighted to get bits of bone and skull brought down from Manassas of the Northern dead, which they passed around with great hilarity. And even going back to Jefferson's time, you see expressions of a feeling that we Southerners are very different from them in any number of ways. And I was wondering if you could comment on this, sort of whether you see this too, a growing sense that North and South are different people and antipathetic to each other as leading up to the war.
Absolutely. Very good point. And I just want to make one point about that they were different people. Lots of different people have not ended up in a civil war. It's not enough when you're an historian to talk about the huge differences between people, because sometimes those huge differences do not result in the war. Look, for example, at the Cuban Missile Crisis. If that Cuban Missile Crisis had ultimately generated a world war, we would all understand it perfectly. The Russians hate the United States. The United States hates Russia. Communists hate democracy. The Democrats hate communists. No wonder there was a world war. But there wasn't. And there wasn't because statesmen intervened and stopped it from happening. So it's not enough for people like me to just point out that the North and the South are getting to be different cultures, because those different cultures are not necessarily going to come to war. That's the first gloss I'd make on your question. But your question is such a good one, that is to say, why did these two sides come to hate each other so much? And I'm convinced that the most important part of that hatred is that both sides think the other is trying to enslave them. The Northerners are convinced that there's a slave power loose in the culture that is trying to destroy white democracy in the North. And the secession is the last example of that. I mean, if you can't have an election and have the winners rule and the losers obey the winners, what kind of democracy do you have? What these Southerners have done is the last step of destroying the great Northern experiment in democracy. And I am persuaded, as I read Civil War soldiers' letters, particularly in the South, that these letters are not concerned about we've got to beat up the Yankees because they're going to free our slaves. Primarily, and that gets to be the case at the end of the war, but in the beginning of the war, it's we've got to stop these Southern armies from invading our homes. We've got to protect our fireplace. We've got to protect our houses from the vandals. And we've got to stop them from trying to enslave us the way they would like to do. And then this rhetoric of slavery really takes over the South when Lincoln decides that he's going to send an army down south to, as the Southerners see it, coerce the Southerners into obedience. But we have a great historian here. Well, how would you answer your own question, Henry?
I think that there was an ethnic tension between, or I don't know how to characterize it, but because I haven't really thought about it very deeply, but I mean, you can see it in Jefferson and in his foundation of the University of Virginia. He was determined that the future generation of male leaders in Virginia not go to the North any longer to be infected with Northern ideas of democracy. You begin to see it in family letters where people complaining, saying that, you know, when the day comes and the South has its own post office, or when the day comes and the South is this or that, then, things will be better. But again, to get back to what started me on this is that, as I was surprised by the avidity with which Northerners and Southerners, slaughtered each other, and that nobody ever stepped back and said, these are our fellow countrymen that we are killing. Let's call a halt and think about this, and we never did that.
I have another question.
Here comes a question that I will not be able to answer. Go ahead.
Yes, well, it's perhaps a little more abstract, but I think it bounces off the others. And that's a question actually of mastership. It's the other part of the whole matter of slavery, after all, because it has its roots in classicism, it has its roots in Greek democracy and Roman republicanism, that there was not chattel slavery, but slavery. All right, so then it's in the New World, and classicist thought is very important, and especially in Southern educated circles. But what I was thinking of particularly was Chekhov's impassioned note, I think in one of the letters of Suvorin, about how his grandfather was a slave and how he how he himself extracted the serfdom, the memory, the strains of it from himself. And you think about that for a long time, and then you think, but wait, what about mastership? What about ownership? Who extracts that from themselves? And what I wonder about American racism, first of all, is it was deliberately, as you say, manipulated to make it to make chattel slavery applicable only to people of color. But along with that, and taking it more forward, there is, and particularly in the South, although not only, a deep hostility to organized labor, to unions, and a kind of, you know, and then the South becomes the area of cheap labor. So it seems to me there's a kind of displacing of master-slave relationships. After all, we start to talk about wage slavery and so on, and the horror in the South of factories in the North was another image of slavery. But the other part of that then is, who gets to be the masters, who wants to be the masters, who will give up being the masters? And can an historian answer that question?
Superb. And the answer is that everybody is afraid of being mastered in this culture. Everybody is afraid of being enslaved. That's what strikes me most about these sources. And you've pointed out here, and I wish I'd used this in example in my talk, you've talked about Chekhov and serfdom. And we always have to remember that all these events that I'm talking about occur in a world context. And in a world context, it's not just blacks that are enslaved. It's whites that are enslaved. It's Russian serfs that are enslaved. And when Southerners say that Northerners are trying to enslave them, that is to say enslave whites, and Northerners say Southerners are trying to enslave us, whites, they're just following world history. This is what's at loose in the 19th century, this mastery of people. And there's no particular reason why it has to stop where it stopped in America, which is with racism. And your question beautifully shows that. Thank you. I could answer one of Catherine's questions.
Superbly.
I want to know what the factor of the fear of European involvement in the American Civil War, how that influenced Lincoln's first inaugural attitudes towards slavery that you were talking about in his address. Did he try to placate certain European powers from not getting involved?
Oh, I think that's a good question. I think the impact of it, the impulse of it is right. Lincoln, too, is aware that he's in a world contest, and that he's aware a civil war might just not stop with the whites in the South against the whites in the North, that England especially may intervene. I think he's always very worried about that, and I think that's a primary impulse behind the Emancipation Proclamation in 1862. And it again points out something that I have to keep telling myself, that you've got to see these events in a world context. That it's not just what happens in America. America's got this twist on everything, which is that only blacks are going to be enslaved. But get rid of that twist, and everything that's happened in the rest of the world can happen in America. And Lincoln and everybody else is worried about that.
One more question? Okay.
I loved your explanation of the causes of the Civil War, but there's one point that I just have a question about, and that is slavery as a moral issue and as a larger force, and how that interacted with the individuals and the statesmen. Could you elaborate?
Well, that's a good point, Deborah, and I didn't mean to slight that, because it's important. I mean, the Southerners do think that Northerners are morally moral tyrants, that they the North has this idea of the South as sinners, and it's intolerable. It hurts their feelings. It hurts their self-respect. They don't wish to hear it. And as for Northerners, they do think slavery is wrong. They do wish slavery was abolished. I mean, Lincoln is saying all the time, my lifetime wish is that all men everywhere will be free. That's important stuff. That becomes an important part of his campaign. But he does not say that because I feel that way morally, I must move to abolish slavery. It's that step from being morally aroused to becoming politically aroused that someone like me and you have to explain.
Actually, I've been given a reprieve for one more question. Bill, thanks for your presentation. One of the points that was at the heart of your analysis is that there were a diversity of voices and factors contributing obviously to the Civil War. I'm particularly interested in the religious factor, and specifically what happens to the voices of white Southern Protestant clergy who may have been opposed to slavery and may have been opposed to secession. I do know that, for example, in the Presbyterian Church in the South, where intellectual discourse was highly prized and valued, that some Presbyterian spokespersons in the church who wrote reams and reams of very fine analysis were able to drown out voices that may not have agreed with the sort of pro-slavery instincts. And in the Methodist Church in the South, for example, there, where you may have had anti-slavery clergy, they were often threatened economically, financially, and even with terror by some of their own members. I'm just wondering, how do you see that playing out in your research, and are there any sort of anecdotes that you might share about what happens to the clergy opposition to slavery and secession?
Very, very good question. And I wish Deborah was the person answering it instead of me, because Deborah's research shows that among a certain group of clergymen, particularly in the Upper South, the feeling that slavery is wrong and that unchristian and anti-biblical causes them to try to abolish slavery and try with various tactics. So there certainly are clergymen throughout this story, particularly in the Upper South where there's less of slavery, who are using their religious convictions to try to change the system, which, by the way, is another one of those complications that I think we have to insist on. The South is not just the South. There are various kinds of Southerners in various kinds of places. You don't have the North versus the South. You have certain Northerners versus certain Southerners in the Civil War, and actually a third of the South doesn't even secede, particularly the border South where these people that Deborah writes about are most important. So that's the first thing. The second thing is there is the most fascinating movement in the Lower South, in the hotbed of slavery, in the places where slavery, where blacks outnumber whites among clergymen, to reform slavery. And their point is slavery's not wrong, but slavery as it is conducted is wrong. It is wrong to break up marriages. It is wrong not to allow slaves to read the Bible. And what we need to do is to reform slavery, not to abolish it, but to make it a humane institution where families of blacks are protected as much as families of whites, and where Christians, black Christians, can read the Bible as much as white Christians can. And some of them go so far as to say that if we can't do that, if we can't reform slavery, we've got to abolish it. And some of them go even further in the Civil War, and they're the ones that fascinate me the most. They say that we're losing the Civil War because we haven't passed our reforms, and it's God's judgment on us. And if we want to win the Civil War, we not only have to get better guns, we have to get a better change in the slavery institution so that blacks have rights even though they're slaves. So you got these two different groups of clergymen, in the Upper South trying to abolish slavery, in the Lower South trying to reform it. In neither case, just going along in a rote way with the system as it exists.
Thank you, Bill. Thanks for inaugurating. Well, sustained applause. You can go home happy. Thanks for coming today. I hope you will come back in the future and bring a friend with you. The next is on November the 9th, if my memory of calendar is correct, featuring Michael Jarvis, who is from the University of Rochester and is currently a fellow at the Virginia Foundation for the Humanities. And he's going to be talking about colonial Bermuda, colonial Virginia. Is that a fair enough assessment of a somewhat more specific topic than that, but that's the general area of interest. So please join us. Thank you for being here today.